Wonderful greetings to all of you, my precious and beloved brothers and sisters. How are you all today? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And the Lord Yeshua said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world. Then the end will come. Time will delay no longer. You know, he who said, I'm coming again, will come again very soon. Be prepared to meet the Lord your God. Pastor Ji, how are
Sashikal,
you today?
How are you?
What's up today?
Oh, you know, you didn't finish on our last talk, time of fellowship.
Okay.
And I went back and I was trying to read about what you were saying.
But I'm sure your wife must have commented something, no?
Well, she was saying that the example, the way the Lord gives to show us, they are simple, but yet much profound.
Okay.
You know, because the, you know, many today want the gifts, but they don't want to pay the price. So that's why we see in the church many gifts that are operating because, you know, she said gifts are without repentance. But the authority that the gifts are going to be manifested in the end time is going to require the qualification of the Lamb.
So what else did your wise wife say?
Well, that's what she was saying, that we have to die to ourselves. In order to have that authority being given, we have to die. There has to be, there can be no competition, you know, between the Lord and us.
Exactly.
You know, either it's like, it's not 10% of me, 90% of him. It's 100% of him, you know. And so we're...
What I wanted to highlight to you yesterday, which we could not finish because we ran out of time, is if you look at Revelation chapter 5 and the verse 6, it says here, the last portion, where there stood a lamb as though it had been slain.
Yes.
Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God. First comes the act of being slain. Then comes the seven horns and seven eyes. A distinction needs to be made there. We can correlate this with what the Lord Yeshua said after his resurrection. If you can quickly turn your Bible to Matthew chapter 28, and it says there in verse 16.
Okay.
Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. So they did not go to any other mountain.
That's good.
They had gone to a mountain where the Lord had appointed.
Yes.
Said, this is my meeting place. This is where you shall come. That is why, you know, the problem with today's charismatic Christianity, it has become a religion of convenience.
Yes.
With all these multiple services, which are necessary because the church is growing. Membership is growing. Church building space is small.
Yes.
Limited, you know. Then people can pick and choose when they want to go. Convenience.
Yes.
Oh, if I go early in the morning service, like one of my former staff, she used to say, a church first service at 5 o'clock in the morning. So I asked her, so you go to early in the morning service, why you choose to do that? She said, so that when I come back home, I can sleep the whole day.
Yes. So I paid my dues.
Yes.
That's it.
Marked, attendance is marked.
Yes.
Then enough, you know.
Yeah.
I come and sleep the whole day. So it has become like a church of convenience. Like another church that I know in a certain foreign nation, they have a regular church service on a weekday, like a midweek Wednesday and a Saturday. Mm-hmm. They have a regular
church service,
just like a Sunday church service, you know. So, one of our staff that I know, this boy, he goes to the church service on a Saturday. So I ask him why. So the whole Sunday we have family time. I paid my dues. I've already attended church. I put my attendance there. They marked me present. So now the whole Sunday is my day. I have family time this day, that day. So when I hear all this, it shows that it's become more of
convenience
rather than a relationship building. Like meeting God where He has appointed you to be met.
Yes.
Of course, some people may argue today, no? Oh, we worship God in the spirit. You have been very legalistic. Mm-hmm. It's not been legalistic, no?
Yeah.
Here, it is the Lord Himself who says here, He had appointed a place.
Yes.
I didn't say that, no? Mm-hmm. So, is the Lord being legalistic?
No.
Couldn't they have said, oh Lord, why in this mountain or that mountain? You yourself said, they shall not worship in this mountain or that mountain. They shall worship Him in spirit and truth. It's you who said that. Mm-hmm. So now why you want us to come to this particular mountain?
Yeah.
They could have said,
you can just come meet us here.
Yes. Yeah. Isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's not convenience, no? So anyway, let's continue because these are all different
subjects.
Okay. Are you keeping note of all the subjects that we need to discuss in the future?
Yes.
Okay.
One that I know. Sowing, reaping.
Yes. Now, this is another subject you need to add.
Okay.
And when they saw Him, they worshipped Him, but some doubted. That's always the case.
Yeah.
And Jesus came and spoke unto them, saying, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Now, this saying, all authority, was only given to Him after being crucified.
Yes.
After being slain. Not before. Mm-hmm. He never said a statement like that before. Only after.
Yes.
Now, keep this in mind. Let's go back to Revelation. Mm-hmm. First, the Lamb as though it had been slain. Now comes seven horns, seven eyes. Seven, as you know very well, being a Bible teacher, is a symbol of completeness, perfection. Mm-hmm. And that is something that is reserved for God alone, mm-hmm. not for anybody.
Right.
On the seventh day, when He had completed all His works, He rested. And He blessed the seventh day. Mm-hmm. So, the seventh is something of completeness. Finished. That means He's complete. All authority. It's not some authority. All authority. Horns in the Bible, it signifies power. So all power, all authority is now in His hands. Because He had prevailed. And the seven eyes, if you can remember very well, during the 2010 Open Heavens Prophetic Conference in Jerusalem, our respected and honorable prophet of God, Vincent Selvakumar, received a powerful revelation from God about the seven eyes.
Yes.
And he preached a wonderful series of messages about the seven eyes. If you would like to know more about that teaching, you may order the 2010 Open Heavens Prophetic Conference DVD series, which you see on your screen right now, and it is available from our website. So that's a powerful teaching He gave about the seven eyes, you know. So the seven eyes again now, the completeness of the all-knowingness of God. Completeness. Eyes all around. The completeness of the omniscience of God. The completeness of the omnipotence of God now being vested in the Lord Yeshua. That is the lion.
Yes.
That is the lion.
That's very good. That's very good. Yes.
That is the lion. Now standing there, the lion has prevailed. That's why, you know, Pastor G, when the Apostle John saw, he was seeing two together at the same time. A lion and a lamb. A lion and a lamb. This is something amazing about the spiritual realm, no? Even I myself, by the multitude of God's grace and mercy extended to an unprofitable servant like me, many times in the spiritual realm I've seen something that appears one and then another at the same time.
Yeah.
It's like this is not that, that is not this, but both are both, but both are one. I don't know whether you are able to make like, let me give you an example, okay? Once I saw a vision of an eagle, but it also looked like a dove at the same time. You are seeing two, but they are one. Only in the spiritual realm you can differentiate like that, you know. But they are one, but they are two. In the earthly realm, you cannot make them like that.
Yes.
Either it's one or two. Here, even if you composite one on top of another, they will blend together. Either one will lose its identity.
Right.
Agreed?
Right.
But in the vision that I saw, the dove's identity exists by itself. The eagle's identity exists by itself. Yet they are one, yet they are two.
So, we come to the place.
Yes.
You know, there was a very good example that you just gave, you know. So, the Lord, Jesus, is one. I am one.
Yes.
But as I lose my identity, the I factor is removed. We will...
The Son factor comes.
That's right. And when you said placing, one of them loses their identity,
yes.
No? So, I have to lose...
Your identity.
Identity so that His can be seen.
Excellent. Give me a five. There you go. So, when we are willing to die to self, die to our passion, die to the I,
desires.
Only then God can trust us with His authority.
Yes.
Which I'm sure you have already heard things like this before. It's not just His authority, no? It's the completeness. You see the seven.
Yes.
Completeness. It's a completeness which are the seven spirits of God. Which means the seven horns and the seven eyes are part of or a different manifestation of the seven spirits of God. Which means the seven spirits manifests as the seven eyes,
right.
And it also manifests as the seven
gifts.
Horns.
Sorry, yes.
Power. Different kinds.
Yes.
They manifest differently. But it all hinges
on that completeness.
On that one thing being slain. Then it can be, you have the authority to look and take the scroll. Even into looking into the libraries of heaven. Been privileged by the grace of God to visit the archives in heaven. You know, there are many libraries. I'm sure you have heard about things like that. And scrolls all kept safely for to be revealed.
Yes.
In order to be privileged to have access into that area, the criteria is a slain life.
Yes.
The crucified life. Then only you will be qualified. to have access into those inner things.
So Santaji, as you're explaining all this, you know, we've spent quite a bit of time on this chapter 5. And we say, I saw a strong angel announcing. That's scroll in the hand. John talks about nobody there to this thing. So through all these things we're discussing and looking in the library with all these scrolls that are there, they're all going to be revealed, no?
Absolutely.
But they're not only going to be revealed through just angels to those who have lived the life of a lamb.
Exactly.
Slain.
Exactly.
To be trusted with that authority. So we have to be thinking kingdom, thinking in those terms.
Absolutely. You see, Pastor G, in Revelation chapter 21, shall we look at that?
Sure.
In 21, you'll find something quite interesting that mentions like this. It talks about the New Jerusalem, city of New Jerusalem.
Yes.
In the city of New Jerusalem, it says here in verse 12, and all the gates, there are 12 gates, and each one of the gates have the names of the 12 tribes of Israel.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So which is the first gate and which is the last gate?
Well, the first gate is the Lord Jesus Christ.
Nay. Here, it says the 12 tribes.
Yes.
So each gate is named after
each tribe. Yes.
So which is the first gate, which is the last gate, named after the 12 tribes. So who's greater, who's lesser? None. We don't know.
No.
Right? Okay, now look verse 14. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles. So a foundation will begin from 1 to 12, no?
Right.
So whose name is on the 1, whose name is on the 12? So who's the first, who's the last?
Neither one of them.
It doesn't matter.
Right. Right.
What matters is the city.
Yes.
The New Jerusalem.
Yes.
That is kingdom mindedness. Mm-hmm. Where you don't exist.
Yes.
Your name doesn't matter anymore. Mm-hmm. Whether you are first or last.
Yeah.
Your name doesn't matter anymore. Mm-hmm. That is the crucified life.
Yes.
That is why the foundation of the kingdom of heaven is the crucified life.
Yes.
You don't exist anymore. The I don't exist. We must come to that level, that stage, where the I does not matter or exist anymore.
Yeah, I see.
Only when we reach that level, then the seven horns, seven eyes, will be entrusted in our hands. Because then, the authority will not be misused.
That's right.
For our own selfish
reasons.
Purpose.
Yeah.
For example, you look at Elijah, the prophet of God. Elisha, the prophet of God. What is the one difference you'll find between the two of them?
It didn't matter.
No, in terms of ministry or power, what's the difference between the two of them?
Well, Elijah received the mantle of Elijah, and he got the double portion.
Okay, so he had two times double portion.
Right.
But if you look at their lives, you'll find that Elijah did not do any miracles for his own personal gain.
Right.
Whereas Elisha did something for his own personal gain, no?
Right.
For example, what did he do? Why are you smiling?
I'm waiting to hear from you, no?
No, that when one group of boys say, oh, you bald-headed man.
Yeah.
He got so angry, no?
Yeah.
And he called bears to come out from the jungle to kill them.
Yeah.
See, this was something that was directed at him as a person.
Right.
Nothing to do with God, no?
No.
But he had that authority misused.
Mm.
Well, come under that classification. But he, whatever miracles he did was two times more than what Elijah did. However, look at their walk with God. It was different, you know?
Mm-hmm.
He called down fire from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And the angel was always with him. Whereas Yeah, it was different. You can see some difference there.
Yes, yes.
But he also had, like, he also saw angels all around him protecting. But it was different. Mm-hmm. He was caught alive, or else Elisha died.
Right.
Difference are there.
Yes.
The difference is the eye factor. The eye.
Mm-hmm.
Willing to die. Willing to let go everything.
Mm-hmm.
Elijah's turning point came when he ran away from Jezebel.
Mm-hmm.
At the cave, he realized that he was not like a superstar when he kind of chickened out and ran away from a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a truly humbling experience for him,
mm-hmm.
to realize that he had run away from the threat of a woman. Of course, there are other intimidating factors, how the Jezebelic spirit can really intimidate a person and scare them to death.
Yes.
You know? But the dying to self is far more glorious than any other thing.
Yes.
The thing that heaven values the most is the crucified life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That is the flesh that is offered as a living sacrifice on the altar of burnt sacrifice in heaven.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You see, if you read Revelation chapter 6, there you'll find that the Apostle John saw the martyrs, you know.
Mm.
The martyrs were all gathered around the altar.
Mm-hmm.
The altar is there. They all are slain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Dead.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why they are gathered there, because they have died for the cause of the Lord Jesus.
Mm.
Died. They were willing to lay down their life, not loving it.
Mm-hmm.
They did not love their lives
unto death.
Unto death.
Mm-hmm.
They were willing to lay it down.
Yes.
So the physical death and the spiritual death. You're willing to die.
Mm-hmm.
It's not easy.
Mm-hmm.
Where you're willing to allow your name to be trodden down upon, defamed, humiliated. Those are all part of the lesson plan, you know.
Yes.
Curriculum.
Yes.
Defamed.
Mm-hmm.
Maligned. Everything.
Mm-hmm.
Just to see whether the tail will still wriggle. Now, have you ever killed a snake?
No, I've not killed a snake, but I've killed like a lizard.
Ah.
And that tail,
there you see,
it's waggling, you know, even after you kill it. If it breaks from the body, it still has some life in it.
So life is still there.
Yes.
So when this kind of persecution comes, God will watch and see whether you are still wriggling.
Yeah.
Or totally dead.
Mm-hmm.
So if it wriggles, means, oh, life is still there.
Yeah.
So let's sign into lesson two. Lesson two.
Yeah.
Complete death. You know, even the angels of God, they come to work together with us.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the angelic realm, there are many categories, you know. But if you read in the Bible, the angel that stood beside Elijah.
Mm-hmm.
See, at that moment, in 2 Kings chapter 1, you'll read there that when the captains have come to arrest him,
mm-hmm.
he said, if I am a true man of the living God, let fire come down and consume you right now.
Yeah.
It seems like from the natural point, he was doing it for himself.
Mm-hmm.
But he was not there alone on that mountain, no? It says that an angel stood beside him,
mm-hmm.
and it was the angel who gave him that counsel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, which means, when he came to the place of dying to self,
mm-hmm.
where he became a zero,
mm-hmm.
I gone, became the sun.
Yeah.
He was vested with authority that the spoken word
would come to life. Yes, I see that the importance of for the end time, you know, and when you were sharing, Sadhaji, about Elijah having to run, It's another good example to see there was no eye there. Because normally one would say, I just called fire down. God listened to me. He did everything. You mean I can't take care of this? God can't take care of this one lady. But he knew the ability that it wasn't in him. And he ran.
So, to conclude, the church of the last days must be a church that is purified by fire.
Yes.
Like it says in Malachi, you know, in chapter 4, where, or in chapter 3, where the Lord will sit like a refiner and refine them so that they become so pure they can offer a sacrifice in righteousness. Malachi chapter 3 verse 3. And he shall sit like a refiner and purify of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them like gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness.
Yes.
This must be done first. This is the crucified life.
Yes.
Because when fire comes, it will burn.
Burn, yes.
So are you willing to stay in the fire? Or you are saying, no, I'm getting out, Are you willing to be submissive and be bounded like what Isaac did? Submissive and be bounded like what the three Hebrews did?
Yes.
Just remain in the fire.
Yeah.
Okay, if we are meant to be fried chicken, okay, praise the Lord. We'll just stand there and move.
Yes.
Are you willing?
Yes.
Are you willing? Or are we going to rebel with the thought, no, Lord, how can you do this? How can you do that? Why me, Lord?
Yes.
A voice will ask, why not you?
Yeah.
See, remember, one of the cardinal characteristics of a lamb is submissive. It went to the shearer quiet and dumb. Never opens his mouth. It knows it's going to be sheared, it's going to be killed, but it was dumb.
Sadhuji, the scripture that Paul said, he says, run to the price of my high calling. It was this, no?
Yes.
That I may die. You know?
Yes.
So that I can have the price.
Yes.
That should be our goal. That should be the end time.
Yes.
Church's desire.
So, we must pursue that.
Yes.
The crucified life. Let this be your goal, my dear brothers and sisters. To allow the self to die, that Christ Jesus may live in you and reign in you. God bless you. Maranatha.